here's a story about Minnie the Moocher. She was a red hot hoochie coocher. She was the roughest, toughest rail. But Minnie had a heart as big as a hay whale. Howdy, howdy.
Welcome. My name is Alex Mann. I'm the curator of American art here at the Chrysler Museum, and we are in Gallery 221, which is the Chrysler's Gallery of American Modernism. This is where we display some of the finest works of art in our collection that are from the 19-teens through roughly the 1930s and 40s, and we're exploring themes of modernity, modern life, changes in styles of painting and art making that are happening in this period, and what artists were thinking, what they were feeling, what's happening historically around the country during this moment through works of art. And we have some fantastic pieces in the collection that touch on some of these themes by some of the biggest name artists from this era, people like Edward Hopper and Thomas Hart Benton. But the object that I'm excited to talk about this afternoon and to share with you all is the Jazz Bowl, this big, beautiful blue piece of American ceramics that is standing next to me that is the newest addition to this gallery. This is a wonderful piece that is on loan to us that we're very happy to be displaying. And I want to tell you a little bit about why this piece is important, where it fits into the history of American art of this time period of the early 20th century, and how this piece and this addition to our galleries, I think, really activates and brings to life some of the other pieces that are already in the collection. So I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about the history of the Jazz Bowl, what this is, why it was made, where it comes from, and then I'll take you into a little more of the story about some of the things that we have on view around it. This big, beautiful blue piece of pottery was made around 1931, and it was a commission that came to the firm Cowan Potteries, and they were based in Cleveland, Ohio. Now, for those of you all who know a little bit about the story of American ceramics, you'll know that Ohio had been, since the 1870s and 1880s, the center for production and design for American ceramics more than any other region in our nation. They were finding magnificent clays in Ohio, so it was a good place to make pottery. Factories were springing up nearby, and these factories needed designers. They wanted to compete on an international market, show their creations at expositions in New York and Paris and Vienna, and so the pieces of work had to be beautiful, they had to be original, and they had to be up to the minute in terms of the latest styles of designs. And so you have happening from the 1880s and 90s on the creation of art schools in many cities in Ohio, specifically to train young artists to be designers, to be better painters, sculptors, drafting, any medium, so that then they could go and work in some of these factories. And this bowl was designed by a young man named Victor Schreckengast. He was 25 at the time. He was from Ohio. He had been to art school in Cleveland, and had gotten a job at Cowan Potteries. Cowan was not the biggest of the firms in Ohio by any means, but it was a good one. It had a strong reputation, and they received a commission from a woman who wanted a large punch bowl as a gift for her husband for a New Year's Eve party. And she asked for something in a, quote, New Yorkish design. And so Victor Schreckengast, 25 at the time, is one of a team of designers working within the firm, and he receives this assignment. He's got to come up with a design that they are going to produce one of these bowls to deliver to this client, and this is what he comes up with. He's thinking about New York. That's all he's been told, and he's got to make a punch bowl. So punch bowl is a great form for a designer. Why? Because it gives them a lot of space to work. And Schreckengast has used the space on this bowl very effectively. So you'll notice it has a very small base, not much room there, so that it can have a very wide open space here in the middle. And he has covered every inch of that with a design. It's not just little vignettes, tiny spaced pictures. It is a wraparound series, almost a collage of different forms. And then, as you'll see, he also created designs on the inside of the bowl as well. So he's really taken this charge, this commission, and said, how much can I do with it? How should I best fill the space and make use of it. So Schreckengus thought about New York and his memories. He had been there and what it suggested to him. And he said, well, New York, for me, 25-year-old guy, what do you expect? It's all about the nightlife. And of course, this is a punch bowl, so it's something that's going to be used for a party, a festive atmosphere. And so what kinds of designs has he used on the bowl? Well, first off, skyscrapers. Here on this side, you have kind of a bouquet of skyscrapers that are springing up and out as if you're down below and you see these rising up above. And then he has, of course, the scenes from the actual party that would have been happening. We have a trio of glasses here, a champagne flute, martini glasses with little olives in them. And then in the front, you have the word jazz. So it's this combination of party, of drinking, of celebration, of music all together, exactly what someone might have experienced if they had gone to a party in New York or gone out to a nightclub during this era. Now, of course, we're talking about the 1920s, early 1930s. So this is during the age of Prohibition. And some of what Schreckengus has portrayed on the bowl would have been things that were illegal at the time period, but not at all uncommon. So the fact that we have alcohol bottles on the back of it, that is completely to be expected because everybody who was going to have a good time in New York was going to find a speakeasy, someplace where behind closed doors they could celebrate. And that was completely understood, something that he wasn't in any way going to get in trouble for. He's just showing people the reality of what they were looking for and what made New York special. And so, of course, nightlife, you also have stars here in the sky, and the bowl is blue because Schreckengus was thinking about the colors of New York at night and how New York probably one of the most, if not the most, electrified city in America in this time period was filled with streetlights, so that when you were out and about in the streets of New York in this time period, you would have had quite a bit of light surrounding you, but it wouldn't have been daylight. And for Schreckengus, his memories of the quality of the light in New York in this time period were that it did have this beautiful blue cast to it that kind of cast all over the scene. So he's used that as the dominant color within this bowl in order to inflect and convey even more closely what his impressions are of the scene. Now, in order to do that, he's got two colors here that he's working with, a sort of black or dark color and then the blue. He used a special technique in order to create this. He makes the shape of the bowl and then coats it in a black slip all the way around and then scratches away the lighter areas that you see. So everything that you see here that is the bright blue color, that was originally covered with black and has been removed. So it works very much like a woodblock print, a relief print. Lino cuts were also popular in this time period. So it's sort of drawing in reverse. You start with the dark, and then everywhere that he scratches with his tool and reveals the white underlayer, that is the lighter areas that you see here. So if you look closely at the surface of the bowl, you can actually see evidence of the hand creation of the design on this piece. The dark areas are solid and flat, and then the areas that are lighter have a visible texture of each one of the individual scratches that is used. And that technique is actually called from the scratching sgraffito, which is an Italian word, sgraffito, the way this was made. So once he's scratched away the designs, then the bowl is glazed in this beautiful Egyptian blue color, and that's where we have the final design coming from. So Schreckengus makes the bowl. It is presented to the client, and she loves it. She likes it so much that she orders two more of them. It is a complete hit. He is their little wunderkind now who has made such a success. And even more remarkable because the client who had commissioned this, unbeknownst to the designer, was someone quite important. It was Eleanor Roosevelt. And she was at that time First Lady of the State of New York, and she wanted to present this bowl to her husband, Franklin Roosevelt, as part of a celebration of his re-election as governor of New York and an anticipation of his hopefully ultimate election to the White House, wanted more examples of these in order to share for all of the entertaining that they no doubt would be doing as political figures, and of course in celebration of their native state of New York. So the fame of the commission, the success of the design, its popularity with these very sophisticated clients, Cowan Pottery, Schreck and Goss's employers, said, we've got a winner, and we need to put this into wider production. So they're going to put this bowl ultimately into the catalog of things that they can make available. They've got the design, they've got the pattern that Schreck and Goss has drawn so that they can do more than one of these. And this bowl then becomes available for any of Cowan's clients to order. They ultimately produce it in three different sizes that would have been at slightly different price points, but in every case, the designs would have had to have been hand done. So the bowl that you're seeing here is not the original bowl that was made for Eleanor Roosevelt. This was something that was made slightly later and would have been purchased by another client of Cowan's once the bowl had gone into mass production. Now I say mass production, but in fact that might be a little bit misleading in this case because each one of the bowls was made individually. They were rather labor intensive and somewhat expensive both to make and to sell, so they weren't getting a lot of orders for the bowl. That's not to say the design wasn't a success, it's just a matter of the price point, the number of clients who were going to want a piece of pottery this big, this grand, this high end. This was probably one of the more expensive and luxury items that Cowan was making at the time period. And you've also got to think about the year in which this was happening. So this is 1931. We're in the middle of the Great Depression. Folks don't have a lot of money in this time period to be spending on anything, much less a beautiful centerpiece for their dining room table or their party. So ultimately, we've estimated that Cowan Pottery's probably only produced somewhere in the neighborhood of 75, maybe as many 100 of these designs before in 1931, they went out of business. Not because of this bowl, just a factor of the Great Depression and that many companies in this time period were struggling. So this is a wonderful piece that we're excited to share and to present in our galleries here at the Chrysler. Not just because of its importance in the history of its connection to the Roosevelts, the beauty and power of the design, but also because it's very rare and we're very lucky to have one of these available to show and to make part of this story. Now, one of the other things I like so much about this bowl is the way in which it fits into the history of modern art, in the ways that Schreck and Goss, even though he was a young art student at the time, is channeling the latest art movements and incorporating them, involving them in his design for this particular bowl. So as you go around and look at all of the different elements that he's used here, the words, the lights, the symbols, the kind of streams, beams of the street lights that are cutting across the city, the bottles, the glasses, everything is collaged on top of each other and next to each other with no regard whatsoever for the scale. You've got a martini glass that's almost the same size as a skyscraper. This is very modern. He's not giving you a realistic scene. He's giving you this kind of collection of impressions that are sort of floating by you in his mind here. And to me, this layering, this complete disregard for scale, the freedom that he's given to the imagery here, and also the sort of simplification of the designs in order to make a pattern for the bowl that can be mass produced, all of those are elements that he's learning from European modernism, from the works of Picasso and the other Cubist artists, and thinking about their ways of looking at the world that are not necessarily connected to a direct view of something, but a collection of impressions that are being brought together, they're being synthesized, and then reproduced with a level of freedom and music and energy that I think are very specific, very original, and very fresh to the 1920s and 30s. So just purely from a stylistic sense, all of that history that I told you a moment ago, put all that aside, you look at this bowl and you say, absolutely, this is coming straight out of the 1920s, out of the jazz age, out of the art movement, art deco. So the idea in this time period that the simplification of these designs was something that was both modern, machine age in a way, but also sophisticated and beautiful, an art style that was symbolic of progress and prosperity and optimism, even though we're in the middle of the Great Depression. All of these things were important for folks to celebrate in this time period and would have been desirable things for them to present at their home, especially in a party atmosphere. So in that sense, this bowl fits in very well with some of the other works of art here in this room that we're really excited to show together. And the most important, the most interesting of those in many ways is the piece over my head here. We've got a very long, wide mural panel here, and this is from 1930 to 32. It's by the American artist Thomas Hart Benton, and this is one of a series of mural panels that Benton created. Again, a New York story here. These were created for the reading room of the library at the brand new Whitney Museum of American Art in Manhattan. Thomas Hart Benton, an American regionalist painter, someone who had studied modern art over in Paris, then came back to the US and said, okay, I've learned a lot about the ways that folks abroad are doing abstract subjects and experimenting with color and all of these wonderful expressive but unrecognizable shapes and designs, and I want to tell stories. And so he's using some of those ideas of color and shape and freedom, but bringing them back into a bigger narrative. So to decorate the reading room of the Whitney Museum Library, Benton creates a series called The Arts of Life in America. And this is one of the panels from that. And here he's got three subjects that he is covering. Radical protest, unemployment, and speed. And they're all sort of mixed together within this piece here. So you have speed over here on one side with all of these emblems of transportation, with the plane, the train, automobile. You have protest and unemployment in the middle, men who are fighting, they're picketing, they're carrying signs that say work and wages. And then we have folks on the far side, two men up on the roof, one with a gun, breaking up the protest over here. And then finally, we have a little bit of the party atmosphere, something that's not mentioned in the title, but directly connects to the Jazz Bowl, with some ladies dancing over here in a cafe in the far corner of the work. So you see some of these same designs happening up here within the mural panel that we have during the bowl. And one of the things I was really excited about when we brought the bowl with its beautiful blue colors and the beams of light moving across the space here, it made me recognize for the first time that, in fact, our Benton mural panel up here is also a nocturne. This is also a night scene. So if you look at the way the beams of light are coming out of the front of the locomotive here, or over in the city, there's this sharp light shooting out of the top of the skyscraper there, or the women dancing at night in a bar. All are happening against this wonderful blue background color, the sort of illuminated night that is the same blue, the same patterns, the same energy, the same city that never sleeps that we have happening in the Jazz Bowl. So these are works that are in many ways perfect cousins, even though the designer Schreckengast was making this in Cleveland and not living in New York. He's thinking about the same stories, the same context, the same atmosphere as Benton. New York was the center of creativity. It was the center of nightlife, the center of progress, and the center of the arts in so many ways for artists all over America in this time period. It's a symbol of American identity and something that comes up over and over again in our galleries and something that's serving as inspiration for artists. Whether the piece is actually meant to be used in a location in New York, like the library mural here, or something that would have been available to people all over the country. You did not have to live in New York City in order to appreciate what's special about the Jazz Bowl and to bring a little bit of New York culture, of that energy and of that excitement, to your own party in Cleveland or Tallahassee or California, wherever it happens that you live. It's all available to you through an object like that. Now, unfortunately, I told you this was made for a library in the Whitney Museum. The Whitney Museum has moved buildings several times since this mural was made, and that's why it's here at the Chrysler Museum. When they changed buildings about 20 or 30 years after this was made, all of the murals were taken down and dispersed. And most of them are now in the collection of the New Britain Museum up in New Britain, Connecticut. But we're very lucky that one of these was acquired by Walter Chrysler and has ultimately come to us, so we can enjoy part of the story here and think about the ways in which Benton was contributing to modern art so powerfully through this and through the other mural-sized works that he did looking at American culture in this time period. Now, the other reason that I'm really excited to have the bowl here in this gallery is to pair it with another bowl next to it here. So we have two pedestals here, two great examples of American decorative arts and high-end, beautiful, sophisticated design from this time period. The jazz bowl on one side, and then over here, the glass American Ballad bowl. And this is produced a little bit later. This comes from 1942, and it was manufactured by Steuben, the glass company, also located in New York, not New York City, upstate New York, but their design offices were in New York City. So in fact, the origin of this actually also came from folks who were thinking and feeling and understanding this atmosphere and this character. It's called the American Ballad Bowl. So we have two different types of music here, jazz on one side, and ballads on the other. Not an illustration of specific ballads, but if you look closely at the bowl or look up other examples of it, you'll see that it is about, rather than contemporary life, this is about history. It's decorated, again, around the sides of the bowl that makes sort of a wonderful canvas for designs here, with four images, four sort of emblems of different moments in American history. We have colonization, independence, expansion, and of course, exploration. So all of these different ways in which people are arriving, exploring, settling, building a country in the United States or in the Americas, in the colonies, before becoming the United States. So we're moving here between 1931 and 1942, and that's part of the reason that I understand the theme, the sort of character of the works shifting from this celebration of contemporary American life to American life of the past, looking back at an older period, older bit of history. And why would this have been appreciated? Why would people have been thinking about the colonies in the early 1940s? World War II. So we have, again, changes in society that are happening. This a product of the Great Depression and of people looking for reasons to celebrate optimistically, hoping for better times. And then here in the war, growing spirit of patriotism. And so a celebration of history, but again, through music, different type of music, jazz, optimistic, modern music, things that make you want to dance, ballads, things that tell stories about history, thinking about the past. So the connections of art and music, I wish we had music here playing in the galleries, but you can decide what might go best between the two, or now we would have two different competing types of music, so it would be either correct for one piece or the other, but I think as a pair, they are a perfect illustration of the way all of the arts in America were coming together in this time period and inspiring works of decorative arts, things that are singular, individual, or opportunities for folks to have fine things in their homes in a smaller scale. So that is my introduction to these two pieces, and I hope many folks are able to come here and see them in person. They are wonderful in their scale, very complex in their details, and magnificent things for us to display and enjoy. So one other fantastic painting that's a part of this story that's kind of the centerpiece of this space is this piece called American Beauty, and it's by Walt Kuhn, and it was done in 1934. So again, we're right in the same time period, and I see this painting as very much a kind of amplification, as if we're zooming in on some of the elements of culture that are part of a big tapestry that you have happening in the Benton mural panel above, but here looking more specifically at nightlife and the culture of performance from the 1920s and 30s. And this is an aspect of American society that was particularly fascinating for the painter Walt Kuhn, and he spent much time in nightclubs and at the circus looking at the performers, looking at those folks who are up on stage to entertain us, but usually in his paintings not presenting them on stage in character, but in these private moments where they are behind the scenes in a way, and often have, I think, a sort of tinge of melancholy to them. So if we look at this woman, I think it's an open question as to whether she's smiling at us. Is this a seductive pose? Or is this something that is maybe not necessarily so open and inviting? Who is she? We don't know her name. He does not tell us. If you were in the audience seeing her perform, would you have known her name? I don't know, necessarily. She's wearing a costume. She could have been one of a number of different performers who were all dressed alike. So there's a sense in which she is an individual person, but at the same time, she's part of a formula for the performance in terms of her costume, with her makeup almost a mask, creating this identity for her as a dancer, but at the same time hiding, protecting, concealing some aspects of her personality. So what do we know about her from looking at this? And what are the mysteries? What is the personality? Who is she really? Does she want to be doing this job? We don't know the answer to that question. So when I see this painting and put it into the context of all of these other works, I see Kuhn is kind of taking us to the other side of this culture of performance, of the optimism of the time period, and saying, well, maybe there is a kind of darker side to this moment. During these years, the Depression was creating economic hardship for many, many people. What are the consequences of that? To what extent is society, is life in New York, this public world of celebration and showmanship? And then where does one find space for one's private life, for interiority, for thoughts, for aspirations, for dreams within this vibrant, musical, and exciting world? I think that's where Kuhn's painting fits, where he's asking questions that are different from those that are being proposed by Benton and by the designers of the other pieces here, but are equally important to helping us understand why art of this time period was so special and compelling. Thank you.